much, ladies and gentlemen. You may be seated.
I'm so tired of talking about how we are God's hands and feet, but it's easier to say than to be. Live like angels of apathy who tell ourselves it's all right, somebody else will do something.
So why did you first attend your church? Why did you first attend your church? That question was asked to 10,000 church members by the Institute of American Church Growth. All right, why did you first attend your church? What would you guess is the number one answer? Is it really slick professional advertising? No, no. Is it a gifted preacher? Only 6%. How about a really cool, effective Sunday school? 5%. How many of you guessed a friend's invitation? If you did, you're right. According to that study, 10,000 people interviewed, that was the number one answer. 80% of the church members said they were a part of that church because a friend simply invited them to attend. Isn't that amazing? We must never, ever underestimate the power of a contagious invitation. So today, we are going to look at a person in Scripture whose very simple invitation was so contagious that it attracted a man to Jesus. But no ordinary man. This guy ended up becoming one of the 12 apostles. Can we all agree that was a rather significant, contagious invitation to get one of the 12 apostles to Jesus? It's the wonderful story of Philip inviting his friend Nathanael to consider Jesus. If you want to follow the story, it's in John, the Gospel of John, chapter 1. In a moment, we'll read beginning in verse 43, but it's a great story. So here's the deal. As we read the story this morning, would you please ask yourself a very simple question? What was so contagious about this guy's invitation? Why was it so effective? Why did it work to get a man to Jesus who would become one of the 12 apostles? Let's look at a contagious invitation. Now, we're going to think of this in steps. Now, I know that kind of sounds rigid and arbitrary, but in a way, there were three steps that Philip used to get Nathanael to Jesus. All right, are you ready? Step one. Step one, be relevant. Be relevant. Very important that we be relevant in giving a contagious invitation. Let's begin the story, John chapter 1, verse 43. The next day, Jesus decided to leave for Galilee. Finding Philip, he said to him, "Follow me." Philip, like Andrew and Peter, was from the town of Bethsaida. Philip found Nathanael and told him, okay, now here's the beginning of his invitation. "We have found the one Moses wrote about in the law and about whom the prophets also wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph." Now that was his lead line. Now you may look at that and go, that's not very impactful. That doesn't sound very contagious to me. Well, we've got to dig a little deeper. I want you to notice where Philip started his invitation. Nathanael was a Jew. Okay, don't forget that. Nathanael was a Jew. That meant as a Jew, he knew all about the coming of Messiah. Well, how in the world would he know that? Well, he'd been to synagogue his whole life, and he had studied the law of Moses in the Old Testament, and he had studied the Old Testament prophets. And when you study the law and the prophets, you hear prophecies about a coming Messiah, that someday a Savior is coming, and he's going to come out of the Jewish nation. He knew all about it. What's going on here? In your notes, let's make sure we get started right. Philip starts on what? Familiar ground, and makes Jesus relevant. Makes Jesus relevant to Nathanael's life. He's saying, man, we found the Messiah. And he immediately connected Jesus to Nathanael's life, and he made it relevant. Now, I'll tell you another guy. This guy is a master at doing this, taking Jesus and then taking his audience and just in a marvelous way making that connection. You know who it is? It's the Apostle Paul. The Apostle Paul. When you study Paul, it's amazing how he can present the gospel with totally different audiences and be so effective. How did he do it? Now, here's what we're going to do. We're going to look at two different examples of Paul. If he's addressing a Jewish audience, he's going to start where they are, namely in the Old Testament. If he's addressing a secular pagan audience, well, they don't study the Bible. So he starts in a totally different place. All right, I'm going to show you two examples, and I want us to learn the importance of being relevant, connecting Jesus with the people in our lives. All right, we're going to start Paul, Acts 13. In Acts 13, Paul is in a synagogue. In the audience that day are two groups, true blue Jews at synagogue, and God-fearing Gentiles. These are Gentiles who we would today call regular attenders. They weren't members of the synagogue, but they regularly attended. So there's those two groups in the audience. Watch where Paul goes to make his initial connection. All right, are you ready? Acts 13, verse 16. In the synagogue, standing up, Paul motioned with his hand and said, "Fellow Israelites, and you Gentiles who worship God," there's the God-fearers, "listen to me. The God of the people of Israel chose our ancestors. He made the people prosper during their stay in Egypt. With mighty power, he led them out of that country. For about 40 years, he endured their conduct in the wilderness, and he overthrew seven nations in Canaan, giving their land to his people as an inheritance. All this took about 450 years. After this, God gave them judges until the time of Samuel the prophet." Okay, I'm going to stop right there. He goes on in this sermon to share how Jesus is the fulfillment of the prophecies of the coming Messiah. But here's my point. Where did he start? Where did he make his initial connection? Old Testament. Why would he bring up the Old Testament at synagogue? Because these people knew the Old Testament. So he started where they were, and he connected them with Jesus, and he did it by being relevant to his audience. Everybody kind of see that one? You want to see another one? Let's go to a pagan secular audience. Very different audience, but watch how Paul doesn't go to the Old Testament. He goes somewhere else. Acts 14, verse 11. When the crowd saw what Paul had done, they did a miracle. They, the people, shouted in the Lyconian language, "The gods have come down to us in human form." By the way, that does not sound like a synagogue, does it? Barnabas, they call Zeus. And Paul, they called Hermes because he was the chief speaker. The priest of Zeus, whose temple was just outside the city, brought bulls and wreaths to the city gates because he and the crowd wanted to offer sacrifices to them, Paul and Barnabas. But when the apostles Barnabas and Paul heard about this, they tore their clothes and rushed out into the crowd shouting, "Friends, why are you doing this? We are only humans like you. We are bringing you good news, telling you to turn from these worthless things. What would that be? Idols. To the living God. All right, now watch where he connects. Who made the heavens and the earth and the sea and everything in them. In the past, he let all nations go their own way. Yet he has not left himself without testimony. He has shown kindness by giving you rain from heaven and crops in their seasons. He provides you with plenty of food and fills your hearts with joy. All right, did anybody feel a different sermon there? Yeah, he didn't go to the Old Testament. Where did he go? Creation. Look at creation. God made this wonderful world. And guess where you get rain and sunshine? God gives you rain and he gives you crops and he provides you with everything you need. Isn't that interesting? When he's with a Jewish audience, he connects with their Jewish background. When he's with a pagan secular audience, he connects with creation. Why is there something instead of nothing? How do you think God, you know, get provision? It's God. God is doing all this. And now God has come to earth in the form of a man. And he goes on in the sermon to connect, guess who? Jesus. Now, what do we need to learn from all? There really is a relevant message here. In your notes, here it is. This is Paul. I have become all things to all men, so that by all possible means, I might save some. What's Paul saying? I'm going to be relevant to my audience no matter what it takes. If I'm speaking to Jews, I'm going to connect with them. If I'm pagans, man, I'm going to connect with them. He becomes all things to all men. We need to do the same. If we want to be contagious when we invite people to come to Christ, we have to start not where we are. We have to start where they are. Otherwise, they'll never see how Jesus connects to their life and to their needs. So, okay, here's the question. Where are the people in your sphere of influence? Do you know where they are? I mean, the people that you work with every day, your neighbors, people you go to school with, okay, your sphere, people you play golf with, your sphere of influence. All right, do you know where those people are spiritually? What's going on in their life? What are their struggles and needs? What are their goals and priorities? What are their hopes and dreams? Hey, do you know this one? Are they going through a stressful time? Are they going through grief or a crisis? Are they going through a challenging transition in their life? How about this one? Do they have a religious background? Did they grow up in the church, or did they never go to church in their life? Those are important things we need to know if you want to be contagious with God's grace. All right, let me give you a personal example. Years ago, I met a college kid, young man, and we got talking, and I found out he was an English major. And I also found out that his favorite was British writers. When he said British writers, I said, oh, okay. Have you ever read C.S. Lewis? He goes, I've never heard of C.S. Lewis. Who is he? I said, oh, he's a wonderful British writer. See what I'm doing? I'm connecting. I said, oh, he's a wonderful British writer. I said, matter of fact, if you'll sit right here, I'll just give you one of his books. Well, I have a stack of Mere Christianity on my shelf all the time. So I go grab one. I say, here, this is a gift from me. It's a British writer. I hope you enjoy it. All right, now to this day, I've never seen this college kid again. Never saw him again. He moved. I never saw him again. But here's the cool part of the story. Months later, through a mutual friend, this friend told me, hey, you know that book you gave that guy? I said, yeah. He said, he read Mere Christianity, and he gave his life to Jesus Christ. Now, think about that. How hard was that for me? All right, everybody watching up here? Here's how hard it was for me to do a contagious invitation. You ready? That was it. Get the book off the shelf, give it to him. That was it. Being contagious in your invitation is really pretty simple when you think about it. So step number one, let's move on. Step number one is what? Know your audience. Be relevant. Make that connection with Jesus in a relevant way. Step two, point people to Jesus. Here's the second thing Philip did. You have to point people to Jesus. I love this part of the story. This is kind of the famous part, you know, because he says, hey, we found the Messiah. It's Jesus of Nazareth. Are you ready? Look what Nathaniel says. Nazareth, this is kind of like Vaughn. This is the ancient Vaughn. Can anything good come from there? Nathaniel asked. All right, here it is. You ready? Come and see, said Philip. Come and see. Notice what Philip did not do. He didn't argue with Nathaniel. He didn't debate with Nathaniel. He didn't try to deliver a clever rebuttal to Nathaniel's sarcastic commentary on Nazarenes. He simply said, you got to come see this guy. Come and see. His goal, you see, our goal is to get people to consider Jesus, just to point people in his direction. In your notes, don't ever underestimate the power of a simple invitation. Very simple. Come and see. You don't have to know all the answers to all the theological questions before you're contagious. You can be contagious by simply saying, come and see. Come and see. You can invite a friend to church next week. You know, I'm looking around. We got a couple of empty chairs. Yeah, we need to fill these up, don't we? By the way, I'm just saying, early service, they're knocking it out of the park. They're filling the chairs. You guys got to get on the stick. They're ahead of you. We got to get with it here at Second Service. So you do invite a friend to church next week. Invite them to your small group or a Bible study or a prayer group. Invite them to a Christian concert that we have here in town. Give them a copy of Mere Christianity or the Gospel of John. Give them a DVD or a CD of Christian music. What's our goal? Our goal, in your notes, our goal is simply to encourage people to consider Jesus as the answer to their problems and the solution to their greatest needs. Let me tell you a true story. It happened on the Mississippi River. There was a Mississippi River boat, and it's going down the Mississippi River. Captain's, you know, guiding it through. And all of a sudden, they pass another boat, river boat, going the opposite way. This captain does the strangest thing. He reaches out and grabs the arm of one of his passengers and says, come here real quick. Look over there. See that boat? Do you see that captain? And the bewildered passenger goes, yeah, what's so special about him? And the captain said, that captain saved my life. Years ago, my boat hit another boat. My boat was sinking. I was thrown overboard in the water, and I was going to drown. That captain steered his boat over close to me. That captain dove in the water and saved my life. And he told the passenger, I just want you to know, I made a commitment years ago that every time I see that captain who rescued me, I'm going to tell somebody, see that guy? He rescued me. That, my friends, is called evangelism. All we do is we point people to Jesus and we say, hey, see Jesus? He rescued me. He rescued me, and he can rescue you too. May we never, ever forget what Jesus Christ has done for us. And may we connect in a relevant way, and then we point people to Jesus, and then the third step is the hardest. Step number three, let Jesus change people. Now, you know why that's hard. Because I want to change people. I want to change people the way I want to change people. Notice again what Philip, our example, does and does not do. Verse 47. When Jesus saw Nathanael approaching, he said of him, "Here truly is an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." "How do you know me?" Nathanael asked. Jesus answered, "I saw you while you were still under the fig tree before Philip called you." All right, right now, this is where we need music background. Do, 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 do. Nathanael's going, "You weren't there when I was under the fig tree. How do you know this?" Then Nathanael declared, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Wow. By the way, did you notice how many times the name Philip was mentioned in step three? None. Where's Philip? He stepped into the background. Philip says, "Okay, I made a relevant connection. I got my friend to Jesus. Okay, Jesus, take it from here. He's all yours." And he let Jesus do the changing. This is Jesus' specialty. Philip didn't even try to change Nathanael. He just left him in Jesus' hands. He knew that his job was to get him there and then hands off. Once Nathanael met Jesus, man, it was all over. Once he met him, he read him like a book, quite literally. And it was just a matter of time before Nathanael was going, "Whoa, you are the Son of God. Nobody can do that because you weren't there when I was under that fig tree. You really must be the King of Israel." Guys, our job description as contagious Christians is to get people to Christ and then just pray. God, work in their life. Change them. In your notes, our task is to get people to Jesus and let him do the changing. Why? Because when we try to change people, we either turn them off and run them off, or, come on, admit it, we change them into our image rather than into the image of Jesus Christ. If we will focus our efforts on just getting people to Christ, let him then begin to speak to their hearts and bring about transformation. You know, Jesus said, remember this passage? "And if I am lifted up, I will draw all people to myself." What do we need to do? We need to point people to Jesus. And if we will get them to Jesus, he will bring about the change. I want to tell you a true story. I love this story. It happened to a young girl named Jenny Smith. She was in the fourth grade. One Sunday morning, her pastor challenged the church to start praying for some particular individual. And here was the guideline. He said, "I want you to pray for the person you know who would be the last person you would ever think would come to Christ." I mean, the person that is so far gone, you just think, man, they would never come to Christ. Fourth grade Jenny said, "I got a guy at school. His name is Matt. He is mean." And she took the challenge. She started praying for Matt that he would come to Christ. True story. Years and years later, Matt went from bad to worse. He got into drugs, ended up getting thrown into prison, just wrecked his whole life. One day, Jenny's like in college. She's at Daytona Beach. She's attending a Campus Crusade for Christ conference, and they go out on the beach and share Christ with people. So one day, Jenny's out walking on the beach, and guess who she runs into? Matt. He got out of prison. He was there for Harley Week. He was all dressed in his black leathers. She started talking to him, and she found out that some of the guys who were at the Campus Crusade for Christ conference with her, some of the guys had befriended Matt, and that morning, Matt had accepted Jesus Christ into his life. This fourth grade girl prayed for his salvation, and God just graciously allowed her, miraculously, to meet him on the beach so she could see the answer to her prayers. Now, she said the best part of the story was the next day. She was back out on the beach. She looked down the way and she saw Matt. He was sharing his faith in Christ with some of his friends. Don't ever stop praying for people. God can change anyone. Heard a wonderful story, true story about a pilot was piloting a small single engine plane, and he was heading for a little small airport, little country airport. Problem was he missed his timing, and the sun went down and it began to be dark. So he kind of hurried up, but sure enough, when he got to this little country airport, nobody was there, no lights were on, no runway lights. He was in a heap of trouble. He didn't know what to do. So he just started circling that little airport. He didn't know what to do. He would circle and circle, and you just watch the gauge on his gas gauge go down and down. Finally, miraculously, somebody on the ground heard that airplane, kind of figured out what might be going on. So he ran out, got in his car, and he headed to the little airport. Problem was, it was locked. He didn't know how to turn the lights on anyway. So he said, what am I going to do? So he got in his car, turned his high beams on, got on the runway, and just started going back and forth, up and back on the runway with his lights on high beam. Sure enough, the pilot looked down, figured out what he was doing, made his approach. The guy in the car got on the end of the runway, his beam shining down, and just parked it there, and the pilot came in and miraculously landed that plane following the high beams on the guy's car. And he made it down. Do you realize who you are in the story? You're the guy in the car. You're the light of the world. You're pointing people who are just circling around looking for the meaning and purpose of life, and you're saying, Jesus is the way and the truth and the light. And your goal is just to light the path so people can find Christ. Some of you will remember years ago there was a Mercedes-Benz commercial on TV. It showed one of their Mercedes-Benz cars crashing into a cement wall during a safety test. And then on the commercial, someone asked the company spokesman, why don't you guys enforce the patent that you have on the energy-absorbing car body? It's a design evidently copied and stolen by every other car company in the country. Why don't you enforce the patent? These people are stealing it and they're using it in other cars. And the company spokesman replied, because some things in life are too important not to share. Some things are too important in life not to share. Jesus Christ is too important not to share. So be relevant. Point people to Jesus. Let him change. Let him transform them. Your goal is to light the way. Why go to the trouble? Because some things in life are just too important not to share. Let's bow. Lord, thank you for challenging us through the wonderful example of Philip. God, help us learn that what Philip did, any of us can do with a simple, contagious invitation. Lord, I pray that this week, would you give us opportunities to share Christ, to invite people, to love people. God, I know in this auditorium, you hate empty chairs. And Lord, you're going to use us to fill those chairs with people who are circling in life, looking for purpose and meaning, really looking for a Savior. May we point them to him, and may we do it in the wonderful name of Christ. Amen.